world of four-wheel drive, there are two, arguably three makes of vehicle that engender such passion, such love, that they could be almost described as religions. I'm at the Stony Ridge Off-Road Academy in Natal, South Africa, where I am joined by John Rich. Yeah, John is one of South Africa's best respected off-road trainers and definitely one of the best I've ever worked with.
And good.
Good. Mm-hmm.
John is helping me do this comparison test between the Jeep Rubicon and the Land Rover Defender, because he's had far more experience than I have with the Jeep. You've had also a great deal of experience with Land Rovers. I've had a lot with Land Rovers, not so much with Jeep. So I thought I'd bring John along to kind of even the playing field. And I don't think there's going to be a winner or loser in this test. I think it's just going to be a lot of fun discovering the good, the bad, and the ugly of these two vehicles.
I think if we leave it at that, that will make a good film on that one.
The Wrangler Rubicon is not an SUV. I think it's wrong to call it an SUV, because typically an SUV, they're built to be very good on the open road, long distances, and then a bit of off-road too. Its very design makes that very obvious. It has solid live axles, front and back, long travel coil springs, front and back, which means that on road it's not going to be great, but off it, it's going to be wonderful. And it has really good clearance, and of course transfer gearing. These same words could also accurately describe this vehicle, the Land Rover Defender, the defender of the faith, sometimes regarded as the icon by which all other 4x4s are measured. And today we're going to see which one is best. Defender on an open tar road. It's so much a truck and not a car. It's vague. The steering is a little vague. No more vague than the Jeep. In fact, maybe even more directional than the Jeep. It's a little bit cramped. It sways around a lot. But you must understand that most people that own Defenders, they have love affairs with them. All of these quirks, all of these characters, the fact that it rattles quite a bit, and the fact that it is, you know, moves around like a boat in a light wind on a lake, they get used to it. They accept it. It's not a negative quality about the vehicle. It's just that the vehicle is full of character. And for a lot of people, when they climb from an ordinary SUV and they drive a Defender, they shake their heads in wonder, thinking, what on earth are you doing driving this awful car? But it's not awful. It's lovely. There's a lovely character about a Defender. And those who love it will sit day after day after day in this quite cramped, limited visibility driving position with vague steering, not terribly good ventilation, and love every minute of it. So while I can criticize the Defender for being this and that, it's actually, given all of that, a lovely vehicle to drive.
These two vehicles, they're so different, and yet again, so similar.
This is a driver's car. By that, what I mean is, you're not going to easily fall asleep while driving a Rubicon. Because, in fact, the steering is so vague and so non-directional that, well, if you could easily crash before falling asleep. It really is not very good at all. The tires on this are stock standard size, so this is what you can expect from a vehicle from the showroom. Put larger tires, as many Rubicon owners do. They upgrade the suspension, they lift it, and they put larger tires on it. I can't imagine how terrible the steering will be. But you can get used to anything, you know. And I think I could probably get used to this as well. The Jeep has very nice big door handles, but is a bit annoying because the door won't stay open. It has just a strap, not any kind of system to keep the door open. The interior is typical American. You sit in the vehicle, not on it. And it's typical, the steering wheel is not slanted at all. It's kind of in your face. There is an integral roll cage which your head nudges, so it's not a spacious interior. The door slam, if you close the door lightly, it feels a bit flimsy, but if you give it a whack, it's actually quite nice, quite satisfying. Now, seating, very good. Excellent seating. There is a nice armrest, cup holders, and ergonomically really quite nice. In terms of places to put things, cup holders, maybe sunglasses, actually not very good. Very nice cubby hole. And yes, that's quite nice up on top there. That works well. Ventilation, round vents in the center and at the sides. This particular model has plenty of speakers, don't know how many. The different models have different numbers of speakers. But one of the most satisfying parts of the Wrangler is the removable roof. Although I'm unable to demonstrate that now, because this vehicle has a roof rack fitted. Right, Defender. Actually a little easier to get into than the Jeep. And the driving position, well, it's more truck-like. The steering wheel is tilted more this way, and I feel actually it's very similar to the Jeep. It's a little bit crowded, a little bit compact. There's not a lot of space to move around in. And particularly with Land Rovers, the door sound is completely unsatisfying to everybody on the planet, apart from Defender owners that absolutely love it. It's almost like a signature, this funny little rattle as you close the door. And I can understand it, having owned a Defender, I can understand that particular very strange appeal. Visibility is very similar to the Jeep. I have a reasonably small windscreen with a reasonably large side window. So big boned people, broad chested people find the Defender very cramped, and it's because of the B pillar here. And as the vehicle moves around, they thump themselves on the B pillar. And you'll notice a lot of Defender drivers drive with their elbows out. It's actually not to look cool. It's because they don't fit. It's just that much more comfortable leaning forward a little bit with the elbow out. In terms of places to put things, okay, there's no armrest at all. It has a center console, but it's too low for an armrest, so there's no armrest at all. Double cup holders, and the center console is actually quite a reasonably sized unit and very useful. And nowhere really to put anything. I suppose you can put something down there, and up here there's a little pocket, so it actually scores very badly in terms of places to put things. But this is nice. In front of the passenger, grab handle and a nice, generous place to put stuff. I like that. That's actually the best part about the entire dashboard on the Defender. That's the best bit. Ventilation, there are only the vents in the middle. There are none on the edges. So if you drive it in very hot climates, this half of you stays quite warm and this half of you stays nice and cool. And the middle of you is really undecided on whether you're too hot or too cold. As for passengers, on the back seat, a little place to put stuff. And there's a handle here, which some could say is a little bit tacky because it's just a strap. I actually quite like it. I think it's got character and it's certainly practical. Okay, here's a problem with rear seat passengers. You have the integral roll cage, which is so nice for taking off the roof, but actually that's very close to my head. I feel a little bit cramped. The speakers are right here, so if the radio is on, the back seat passengers are going to get a full blast of audio, much more than the front seat. So I imagine that it's not going to be a great place to be if music's playing other than having a party. But the seats are quite good in terms of leg room, really quite generous, but they're very firm. The seats are very firm. And in fact, if I move into the middle, that's very hard. So I imagine a middle seat passenger long distance is going to grumble and complain. Not a particularly wide vehicle, but not narrow either. But I imagine that for a long distance trip, back seat passengers are going to have to be, given its firm suspension, a pretty hardy lot. Okay, back seat passengers, a little bit easier to get into than the Jeep. I'm sitting very high up on an extremely firm seat. Now, it has manual windows that only go down to there. So that's very uncomfortable, okay? And my seating position as a passenger in a Land Rover Defender at the back is terrible because my eye line, I'm actually looking at this bit here. To see animals or anything, I've got to stoop. It's claustrophobic, it's uncomfortable, the seats are quite supportive but very firm, and the legroom is fair, not really bad at all. But the height is a problem, you're so high. And again, you've got the C-pillar here, right here against you, and you're going to be thumping the C-pillar all the time, it's right there. So it's not a great place to spend a long, long time. But in terms of air and space, this feels more airy than the Jeep. It actually feels like I've got more room to move around in. I am being very critical of the back seats of these two vehicles. But one has to remember, they're not SUVs. They're not designed to be really comfortable. That isn't the primary objective in the designs.
But what is important and vital if these vehicles are to be used as overland tourers is the packing space.
The Jeep's tailgate is a little unusual. Split, but split top bottom. They have a strap, but they also have a linkage here that, so this will stay open if the vehicle is parked on a bit of a slope. Now, in here, in terms of overlanding, packing lots of stuff, I can see a few problems immediately. The seat belts are attached directly to the integral roll cage. So if you're now going to pack stuff here and it's going to push on these belts, your backseat passengers are going to have a problem. And off-road, when things are moving around, or overland, things are being shaken around, things are going to fall onto this belt and going to make backseat passengers' lives a little bit difficult. In terms of space, it's not bad, it's not particularly large, and this very large speaker here, this kind of thing actually really annoys me. I understand, you know, it's a subwoofer and you wanted this part of the vehicle. That takes up so much valuable space. I'm sorry, I need that space. I really do need it for packing my stuff. So this kind of thing annoys me. This is a personal thing. So for long distance, heavy loads, and a lot carrying lots of stuff, it doesn't score particularly highly in the back here. Right, space in the back. This is where the Land Rover scores in a massive way over the Jeep. This is a big space. This is probably, my guess is, the biggest in its class in terms of the amount of space that I've got. The width, there are no speakers in the way, there are no funny bits of plastic trim to get in my way. It's pretty square. This drawer system here is aftermarket. It's a big space. The only limitation really is you have limited access because the door is quite narrow and the vehicle is of course much wider. So to get stuff in and out of here, this is the old design that is the carryover, but in terms of place to put stuff, nothing, or I can't think of anything, beats a Land Rover Defender 110.
No true off-road vehicle has a tight turning radius, but some are better than others. The Jeep we have on test is the Wrangler Rubicon. It's the off-road version with built-in traction control and differential locks and lots more off-road kit besides. It's powered by a 3.6 litre V6 petrol engine, and this one has the automatic gearbox. Now, I'm not too sure if this is fair. You see, the Land Rover we have here is a near stock 110. Manual transmission is the full-time four-wheel drive with a lockable center differential, and the axles have no differential locks, although this model does have Land Rover's own standard electronic traction control.
The Land Rover's transmission consists of a permanent four-wheel drive with an open or non-progressive center differential. That means that when it is unlocked, whatever wheel that has the least resistance will spin. So that vehicle is in four-wheel drive right now, and yet one wheel is rotating and the vehicle is in effect bogged down. But the Defender has traction control, but the traction control only works left and right, not front and back, as we will now demonstrate.
Add some power and the brake-activated traction control begins to work, and the opposite wheel gets power.
If we did the same with one of the rear wheels, exactly the same would happen. For this vehicle to have any proper four-wheel drive transmission working, one has to lock the center differential.
The locked center differential means power goes to both front and back axles. But the Jeep is different. We've put the rollers under the back wheels because the Jeep has part-time four-wheel drive.
We've got the vehicle on the rollers. We have an open differential here that the wheel with the least resistance is spinning out at the moment. To get this vehicle off these rollers, I'm going to have to stop him. So we're going to stop the vehicle, engage four-wheel drive, which will engage the transfer case. So I'll have a 50-50 drive from the front to the back. It's called part-time. Okay, drive forward. And then I've got drive on my front axle and the vehicle easily pulled off the rollers.
Putting the Jeep in four-wheel drive is the equivalent of locking the Land Rover's center differential. Like the Defender, this Jeep has brake-activated electronic traction control. And it's time now to find out how this all works.
Right. To test the downhill hill descent control of the Wrangler Rubicon, and it has some neat bits of kit built into it, not so?
With the hill descent control activated, you select first gear on that one, so you'll go to the manual shift.
So I'm going to drive.
And then just push across towards me. And
there you go.
You'll see one, yeah? Okay.
Yes.
All right. Have you activated the hill descent?
The hill descent control is that button there.
That is correct. And there's a green light.
Green light is on.
Okay.
Handbrake down and I'm in four low.
It's really, really nice, the speed they've selected for
this. The speed they've selected.
Yeah.
This is a good speed.
It is a good
speed. You've got total control. If I apply power now, will it...
It will drive
disengage
forward.
Or and then re-engage when I took my foot
engaged,
off the accelerator.
But you just override it with the acceleration on.
Okay.
The Jeep's hill descent control is brilliant. At just the right speed, I can slow it further by using the brakes, and if I dab the accelerator, it instantly disengages.
It really is nice and slow.
Oh, it's nice. Right now, Land Rover Defender, a little bit simpler. I'm in low range, differential is locked, and I'm using first gear. Now, I want to make a point here.
Yeah.
Inexperienced instructors will say, use engine compression when going down slope. In this slope, engine compression is not enough. We go too fast and you'll damage the vehicle. So in the first section, I'm not using engine compression. I'm using brake, very smooth control until the point where I can use engine compression safely. Because if I just rely on engine compression, it will go down far too fast and damage the car. Am I right?
That is correct. But okay. We're also going to do something slightly different as well. We're going to have the clutch fully depressed. So it's not pulling against the vehicle.
I understand that because of the anti-stall device will prevent us applying proper control on the brakes.
Yeah.
We've actually got to disengage the transmission.
That is correct.
Yeah.
Then you can go.
But I'm in low first. But I'm in low first. My foot is on the clutch, and if I get into trouble, I can say, okay, let's rely on the engine compression as my backup.
Brilliant.
Okay. And now I'm going to release it and let it go.
Just let it go and see what happens.
Look, it's more work to do than the Jeep, but it feels equally safe, equally controllable.
The Defender's compression braking is fair. The descent speed on the second half was a little too fast for me. Any steeper, and I would have to use brakes all of the way down.
Andrew, you know when it slid in the cross-axle, how did you feel?
Oh, fine. I didn't do anything that I absolutely fine.
Now, let's take it back up again. But which gear to use?
One. Try and keep it nice and smooth.
Yeah,
she's great.
An easy climb. Too easy, actually. It's time now to test the two vehicles a lot more.
That's quite an interesting slope.
I'm going to give us a little bit more of a challenge on the slope.
Okay.
I'm going to push it to the left-hand side of the slope.
All right.
Okay. I have a bank to climb. I have slippery stuff down below. I have a cross axle just on where that rock is up top there.
Right.
So it's going to challenge us on the climb. Yeah.
Okay. A little bit more a challenging descent now. We're going to go hill descent and... I'm sorry to say, a bit of a non-event again.
Yeah.
It's very easy to drive, isn't it? Yeah. Okay, how's my line doing? You run it from here?
Yeah.
Right, pre-flight for the climb, we're going to make sure that the hill descent control is on.
That is correct.
Because if we roll backwards, it'll catch us. I want to keep the lines similar for both vehicles.
Keep things on an even footing, I've not used the Rubicon's axle differential locks. Now the Land Rover up the same slope.
Right, pre-fight on Land Rover's a little bit easier. We have our center differential locked and we're a low range and we're going up in first.
Yeah. Your line is good, slightly to the left.
To me, the Jeep has the clear advantage. While the actions of the two traction controls is similar, the wheel travel is better on the Jeep and is providing better traction up the slope. Another consideration is that the Jeep's track, or distance between left and right wheels, is quite a bit wider than the Rover's. This means that holes dug by other vehicles with narrower tracks are not going to affect the Jeep as badly. And I think that's what we are seeing here. What we have done is made other things we can control equal. For example, the tires they are running are the same, and the pressures are the same. I could take a faster run up this slope, but the point of this is to compare the two vehicles.
Okay, you think I've gone back far enough?
No, you're plenty back.
Okay.
So I'll leave that test to the vehicle's owners. I'll just reposition my wheels and persevere. Now the owners driving their own vehicles with their own driving styles. I said that the Jeep's wheel travel exceeds that of the Land Rover, and that its wheel track is considerably wider. On this axle twister obstacle, these can be easily seen. Both vehicles' approach and departure angles are among the very best of any 4x4 station wagon available. The bumper fitted to this Jeep is not an original Jeep front bumper. But as it can be seen, both vehicles score high points with both approach, breakover, and departure angles. This experiment, this comparison between these two vehicles, was one of the most fascinating things I've done in years with 4x4s. I really didn't know what to expect. If you're one of these YouTubers that love to go and point fingers, if you think I'm biased one vehicle to the other just because I'm British, go and watch another channel, please. Go away. I'm not interested. Okay, the idea was to see which vehicle performed better under different circumstances, different terrains. Now, unfortunately, in Natal, they've been having the driest season they've had for over a decade. So we couldn't do our mud trials. So what I thought I would do is I would challenge both vehicles in one or two obstacles where we would be able to see some obvious differences. Mud and water, deep water, it's very, very difficult to see differences. They're both great off-roaders. They're the top of the pile. There are few vehicles out there that are better. So what would we do to really be able to learn something about these two vehicles? And I think we've achieved that. My conclusion is that when it comes to, there are two elements of off-roading. One of them is off-road driving, rocks and sand and mud and all of those. You know, it's great fun driving off-road. And then there's the overlanding. That is the travel and touring element of off-road driving. And some people do both. Some people do just one. I do both. These are my conclusions. Off-road, the Jeep is better. It's easier to drive. The traction control systems of the two vehicles, I think, are very similar. I don't think one is better than the other. I am excluding, for obvious reasons, the differential locks that are standard on the Rubicon version of the Jeep, because the Land Rover does not have differential locks. So, and if I look at the two vehicles, well, it's better. It's easier to drive off-road. It's better going down because the hill descent control is fantastic. They've tuned it just, I don't think I've driven any vehicle ever with a such a well set up hill descent control as that Rubicon has. The Jeep, of course, the Land Rover, of course, doesn't have hill descent control. So we had to rely on compression braking, and sometimes you can't do that because it's just too steep. You then have to rely on control, you have to rely on grip, you have to rely on the wheel travel to keep grip as the wheels drop into different troughs down the slope. The Jeep was better. Okay, now the Land Rover is a much more old-fashioned design when it comes to this transmission, and so its electronic traction control, even though it's fitted to an old-fashioned vehicle, actually worked very well indeed, as we could see with the climbs. But the Jeep was better in the climbs. The wheel travel is better, and we proved that again after those climbs. We went and tested it. I wanted to actually see on a set piece of terrain which one's vehicle travel was better, and the Jeep's is considerably better. It would have to be a scientific test to say how much better, but my impression is a lot better. And that is the main reason why climbing that slope, it climbed easier. The wheel track is, of course, wider on the Jeep, which meant that we couldn't put all four wheels on exactly the same terrain with both vehicles. But then which vehicles are identical? What vehicles, when you compare one with the other, have exactly the same track, exactly the same wheelbase? So the wider wheels track on the Jeep in this situation may have also been a contributor to making its hill climbing efforts a little easier. As overland vehicles, there's no comparison to which one is better. The Land Rover is far better. The main reason being, yes, more packing space. Yes, of course, that helps. You can fit a roof rack onto both of them. So at the end of the day, what will be able to carry more stuff? The Land Rover. There's no comparison. It's a done deal because of its payload. Now, a Land Rover in standard form, I'm not going to give the figures here because I might get them slightly wrong, and then all the YouTubers go, la, 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 give me a hard time. Okay, the Jeep's maximum payload equates to approximately a full tank of fuel and 5 adults, and that's it. So you have to then go and get aftermarket suspension springs to increase the payload. You can do that with the Land Rover too. The Land Rover's payload is very, very good in standard form. And of course, lots of room in the back. And it's all a matter of functionality and practicality. I'll give you an example. The Jeep has a relatively small fuel tank and high fuel consumption when compared to the Land Rover. So you now need to increase your range. Now, for an overland vehicle, you need 1,000 kilometers, 600 miles minimum. Okay, that's to begin with. So you need to make sure your vehicle has got that kind of range. And if you need to carry extra fuel, well, then you can, of course, in the Land Rover, carry lots of extra fuel because the payload allows for it. And with the Jeep, it doesn't. So how do you increase the already limited range on the Jeep? Change the springs up. But now you can only change the springs so much. The axles themselves have maximum tolerances. So you can't just go and load and load and load and load and load. There is a limit. The limit on the Land Rover far exceeds the limit on the Jeep. So as an overland long-distance tourer, and I'm talking about Trans-America, Trans-Africa, you know, crossing Australia, that kind of long-distance stuff, the Land Rover is a clear winner, mainly for that reason. I asked the other participants in today's test what single unique character makes their vehicle special for them.
It gives you it provides you a sense of being invincible. Everything is so well thought out and put together that driving it, no matter where you are or where you're going to, it's never an issue. You just use it and it goes.
Everywhere where you go and you stop, the guys always come and talk to you and swap stories out. And the unique thing about, another unique thing about a Land Rover is you can bolt on anything, drill holes, and make it like your own personal vehicle, just like you want it.
John, when teaching somebody how to drive a four-wheel drive, what is the single most important thing that you want them to leave with after they've done one of your courses?
Andrew, thank you. The single most important is for the person to actually understand what the vehicle is doing. They're all different, so the person comes with his or their vehicle on that one, and they need to understand their vehicle, where to place their wheels, and the power from that vehicle. More than just driving the vehicle and going out there, you need to respect the environment out there, less wheel spin. So the more they understand their vehicle and truly get to enjoy their vehicle out in the bush, I think that's, to me, is the most important
thing.